I usually don't use the mic. The first thing I wanted to do is thank this. Of all the different conferences I've gone to speak at, LASTO has probably been the most successful for Operation Lifesaver. Operation Lifesaver is a nonprofit organization, and our sole goal is railroad safety. And so I met up with Mr. Reed several years ago, and Eric Johnson with East Baton Rouge Parish School Systems. And we started teaching their bus drivers, and I expressed to them that I was only being able to reach a couple of different parishes to give this presentation. And Mr. Gary very quickly invited me to come speak at y'all's conference. That was 3 years ago. So I came and gave a presentation, and quite a few more of you called. We were able to do the presentations. I checked with the state director last week, and I'm going to attribute almost all of it to this conference, but we have almost tripled the amount of presentations we give to bus drivers in the last 3 years. So that's on you in this conference. So every once in a while I meet people that aren't a member of your organization, and I strongly endorse it and encourage them to join. I know that y'all learn a lot of good things here, and it's a great opportunity to share ideas. So I really appreciate it. When I say doubled and tripled, we're getting close to almost 3,000 presentations in a year in Louisiana. So that's awesome for us, where we were right around 500 before we started. So that's really important to us. So thank you very much, and I really appreciate the opportunity to be here. Here's how I can help. You're the administrator, so I will come in, and these presentations are free. Me or one of the other presenters we have throughout the state, I mainly do Southeast Louisiana. Because of LASTO, y'all have stretched the term Southeast quite west and all the way south. So, I love coming. I appreciate it. I know it's sometimes hard to get a hold of me. My information will be, Mr. Gary has it. I think it's posted on the LASTO website. I apologize, just hard. I'm all over the place, but I love to come and speak to your bus drivers. I can't tell you, when I come to different areas that I actually don't, my company doesn't operate, I try to bring the local police officer that's from that area with the railroad so that he can have some interaction with y'all and see the importance of doing this. All current bus drivers, includes teachers, coaches, new hires, we do joint force initiatives where we'll actually team up together and go out and we'll do an audit at a crossing. We'll sit there and we'll see who's doing right and who's doing wrong. If it's a serious violation, we have the ability to pull them over and actually cite them right there. That's what I prefer not to do, but sometimes that's the only thing that we can do and has to be done. We also have a Rail Safety Week where we can contact you and send out maybe flyers and stuff to help people remember. We have Safe Crossing Week, and then at our website, oli.org, it's listed at the end of the presentation, there's an actual module just for bus drivers. It's an interactive game that your bus driver can go through, and it tells them what to do when they approach a thing. I actually failed the first time I played the game, so I thought I could probably pass it, winging it, but there's a lot going on inside a school bus, and so It's a pretty challenging game, but it's all about just helping us remember. This is the reason why I do it is the big one right there. It's to save lives. That's why I do this. It's actually a small portion of my job, what I'm required to do. I easily meet what's expected of me, usually by March or April of every year. I've done the amount of presentations I'm required to do. But I feel that this is so important. That's why I keep doing it throughout the year. I travel all over to get this message out. It also prevents injuries, and it protects our communities and the environment too, because most of the railroads in Louisiana move petrochemical. I mean, that's a huge part of our industry. And so we don't want that stuff leaking out. We've all seen what happens when it does. Okay, it happens every day. And so I don't know that it's actually happened yet today, but a number of you who have become my friends commented on the incident yesterday in Biloxi, right? We all heard about Biloxi. Four people unfortunately lost their life. A couple other ones are right there on the edge, right, in serious condition. That was a passenger bus, it wasn't a school bus, and the investigation is still ongoing. That wasn't my route, the railroad I worked for, that was another, one of the Class 1 railroads. But there's a few things we know automatically. We know at some point the bus got stuck on the tracks, looked like it high centered. Whether the train was already approaching at that time or not, we don't know yet, but I'm thinking that there probably was a little bit of time in between the time it got stuck and the time the train actually approached. There probably looks like may have been enough time for them to have contacted the railroad had they done it the right way and prevented that tragedy from happening. Immediately upon getting stuck on the train tracks, even if a train wasn't coming, probably should have started an evacuation of that bus, because it looks like that wasn't done either, right away, just initially looking at it. But that was yesterday. Unfortunately, there'll probably be something tomorrow or in the next couple of days. We are seeing a decline in railroad incidents, but not until it's zero, we're not going to be happy. So one other thing that I point out to you, I don't point out this out to your bus drivers, but I just want you to ask yourself, this is not to be answered out loud, what is your school board doing to make sure your bus drivers are safely navigating over these crossings? Anything? I hope that it's something, because I seriously have a problem with lawyers. Seriously, I don't care for them. I like the ones that tell me, well, I'm the good lawyer. And I'm like, well, if I didn't have bad lawyers, I wouldn't need good lawyers either, right? So I don't like them. And they're just laying in wait for something to happen. They're gonna come after the railroad. We're an easy target. They're also gonna come after the parish or the school system you work for, because they see those as bigger pockets. So if you don't want to do it for the safety aspect, you should definitely do it for the liability, in saying that, look, we do this, we do it yearly, we do it every 6 months. We have a program in place that helps us, because we know this is a danger, and there's very few parishes in the state that are not affected by railroads. And even if you don't have railroads in your parish, this fall, especially with football season, your bus drivers are going to be transporting those students to other parishes, and they are going to be navigating over our railroad crossings. Anytime is train time. This is just simply stating if the train usually comes through at 8 o'clock in the morning, it's not always going to come through at 8 o'clock in the morning, and that's not a safe bet to make. That the train's already come through, or I'm 10 minutes early, so I shouldn't have to worry about it. Anything can affect train traffic. The weather affects train traffic. The crash yesterday in Biloxi affected train traffic. That slowed every train down or sped every train up in different areas. So any little thing can do it, and it can be an event like a wildfire in Oklahoma can actually slow trains down in Louisiana. So it doesn't have to be a local event to cause delays in trains or to have unscheduled trains coming through the area. The stopping distance, I'm always impressed by this because of y'all. I think it's pretty impressive that a school bus can stop in 230 feet at 55 miles an hour. My railroad train, my freight train, is 5,280 feet or more, which is commonly referred to as a mile, right? Of course, I've watched the news pretty closely the last 24 hours. I heard one of the witnesses, who probably was suffering a little bit from shock, said, look, the train just kept coming. And I looked at my wife, and I said, did you hear that? She said, yeah. And I said, well, where do you think it was going to go? You know, it kept coming because it was on the tracks. That's why they can't turn. So it's going to keep coming. That's the problem. It's going to stay on those tracks. And even when the brakes applied at maximum, which I'm sure they were before he hit the bus, it's still going to travel. If it was going 55, it could travel up to a mile. Obviously, it wasn't going that fast based on how far it pushed the bus, but it still was going at a pretty good speed if you see how far it pushed the bus. Can't swerve. There's no steering wheel in there. When I'm not giving presentations or functioning as a police officer of the railroad, I serve as a freight conductor. I run train. In fact, next week in Chicago, that's probably what I'll be doing. And so when I'm on there, I'm actually sitting in one of those seats up front, watching those crossings and usually cringing, hoping that people will stop and just wait a few minutes for us to get across that crossing. And this is what it looks like when they don't make it across the crossing. If you notice from this picture, They've been shoved down the track significantly. These were construction workers late for work and got shoved down the track. The double fatality. 18-wheelers, just like the bus yesterday, don't fare much better. They may be the king of the road when it's comparing capacitor vehicles, but compared to a train, it's not even close. The main thing is the weight ratio, right? So a train hitting a passenger vehicle is the same as your passenger vehicle striking an aluminum can. It's 4,000 to 1 weight ratio. For every pound your car weighs, that train weighs at least 4,000 pounds. What would we do if we saw on the tracks? This is important. This is important to teach our bus drivers too. They have to go through the drill of how to get kids on and off the bus, right? Most of y'all have a drill for that, right? This is a scenario for that drill. The important thing about the drill is to remember that they're probably going to be cut off from half the kids on the bus, because if half of them are getting off the back of the bus and going hopefully in that 45 degree angle away from the train, the bus driver in the front half of the bus will be going in the other direction at a 45 degree angle. And most buses don't have an aid on there to where you can divide it up. Probably wouldn't be a bad idea to have a responsible student, if you can find one, take that charge. Make sure he's in the back of the bus and he knows what's going on, so that you can evacuate that bus as safely as possible. And to make sure they get far, far away from the train. This is what I hope we find out. Didn't happen. But every public crossing now is required to have one of these signs. That's a fake number up there. This is a real number, but this is for the CN Railroad that operates in Southeast Louisiana. There should be one of these signs. The federal government came up and said this is pretty much a uniform size, and it has to be the blue and white. The moment something happens on the railroad tracks, you call the number and you tell them that I'm at 866-143-R, if that's the crossing you're at. The reason why is, if I tell the people in either Montreal, Canada, or Chicago that I'm on Airline Highway at the railroad tracks, what town am I in? Baton Rouge? Yeah. Gonzales? Yes. Laplace? Yes. It even gets better than that. I'm from Hammond, Louisiana. They called me after being with the railroad for a couple of years and told me to head over to Amite, Louisiana. There was a problem. I've never heard of Amite, Louisiana before. So I assume they meant Albany, Louisiana, which is just about 10 miles west of us. So I told them Albany. They said, there's no L in it, Fletcher. I said, well, how do you spell it? So she spelled it to me. I said, there's two ways to say that. If you're from the town, what is it?
Amite.
Amite, right? Amite from the town. If you go north of there into Mississippi, there's a county by the same name, and that's a mid-county, right? There ain't no Amite. Nowhere. And when you tell them that Chapatula starts with a T, you're going to confuse them too, right? We have some unique names in South Louisiana. So the federal government, realizing that, has come up with this number system. It's always going to be six numbers in one letter, alphanumeric, for that crossing. So when you say at this one, if I was at this one, 836-597-H, they're going to know exactly where you are, even though they may not be able to pronounce the name of the road. They're also going to know which railroad is operating on those tracks. So if you call it in to the wrong railroad and you give them that number, they're going to say, hey, that's the Kansas City Southern, or that's the Union Pacific. They're going to be able to know, and we're going to be able to get that train stopped. This is what I hope didn't happen yesterday. I hope that that bus wasn't sitting there for 5 minutes and they were looking at this sign and didn't call the 1-800 number on that sign and say, hey, we're crossing 866-143-R. Stop all train traffic. Because with 5 minutes of warning, I promise you, we wouldn't even know that this happened yesterday. Because it wouldn't have made the news this far away. We wouldn't know about it. Because in 5 minutes, I know that they could have stopped the train within 5 minutes. So 1 or 2 minutes probably would have been iffy. I don't know. But with 5 minutes, that's probably the most important thing. The only other thing too is, this is a 24-hour number. It says emergency on here. I hate to tell people it's an emergency number, because what's the emergency number? 911. The problem with calling 911 for railroad emergencies is then the 911 operator has to call this number and try to figure out what's going on. So it just adds another step and getting the train stop safe. The other thing is there should, as a former municipal police officer, there should be like a criteria for what means emergency, right? We shouldn't call 911 for every incident. So I kind of hate to call it an emergency number, because on the flip side, any railroad incident, we don't mind you calling the number. And I'll tell you a great one. Back in East Baton Rouge Parish is the one I'm usually in. There's about 800 bus drivers there. I give them this presentation every single year. I have for almost 10 years. I give them my cell phone number. I said, call me. If you see something, call me. Well, one of them called the 1-800 number one time and said, this is exactly what they said. The crossing doesn't feel right. That's exactly what they said. The crossing doesn't feel right. So they called me. Canada called me and said, Josh, one of your bus drivers said the crossing doesn't feel right. And they were laughing about it. They said, what does that mean? I said, look, I don't know what it means. I'm going to run over there and check it out. The rail was broken. That's a big deal. It caused a derailment. What happened was the bus driver didn't know, but they knew when they hit it in their bus, it gave what it was. It didn't feel right because it was giving a little bit, because there wasn't nothing holding on to it. It was broken. It was giving a little bit. And so we were able to fix that problem, never had an incident, because the bus driver was paying attention, called in, even though they didn't have to describe exactly what was going on, they said, it doesn't feel right. Well, I got out of my car, looked around, and I saw the rail was broken. It was pretty easy for me to figure it out. And I called him right back and said, hey, got a broken rail over here. So, and I don't think anyone was laughing in Canada, right? Because they saved us from derailing something, more than likely. So I tell your bus drivers to call for anything. I don't care what they call. I don't care. We had a lady call because she said the bridge was washed out. And it was a beautiful day like today, and it hadn't rained for maybe weeks before that. So I race over there with one of the high-up railroad officials. We're out there checking this bridge, and it looks perfectly normal. And so I call the dispatcher, which is minor in Canada, and I said, look, man, I don't see anything wrong with the bridge. Can I talk to the lady who called it in? They said, sure. So they hooked me up to her. She had a very thick southern accent. And I said, ma'am, I'm out here at the bridge, and I don't see anything wrong with it. She said, no, son, the crossing is wallered out. And I said, all right. So the crossing was, it was a rough crossing. I'm not going to lie and make any bones about it. It was wallered out, all right? That was a term that my Canadian counterparts did not understand. They didn't know what wallered was. Even after I told them what it was, they said, we don't get it. And I was like, look, you ever drilled a hole and need it just a little bit bigger? So you back the drill out halfway, just kind of run it around in there and make the hole wallered out, right? But they didn't get it. But anyway, let us know. So there's going to be communications issues. This really will slow down and stop. I tell bus drivers, call me all the time. They do. I find them and the police are my most reliable sources of letting me know what's going on my railroad. I cover 236 miles of railroad by myself. On the weekends, I take the other guys, we trade off every other weekend, and I have over 1,000 miles of railroad. There's no way for me to be all the time on there. But your professional drivers that work for you, they are going over those crossings every single day. And they call stuff into us all the time. It really helps us be safer and more efficient. So I appreciate my relationship with bus drivers, and I appreciate the opportunity that you afford me to come and speak to them and get to know them better. So we've done two things to make crossings safer. One is passive crossings, which the easiest way to remember that is there's no electricity involved. Signs, pavement markings, the no passing lines. The cross buffer, the yields, which is a yield sign in itself. And then we have active warning, which are lights, gates, bells, whistles, horns, anything else we can think of. Which one do you think is safer? Or do you remember from last year? You think passive or active are safer?
Passive.
That's right. Passive are safer. We have a lower fatality rate at passive crossings than the lights and gates. People are always coming up to me telling me they need lights and gates because it's a dangerous crossing. And I'm thinking, well, I don't know that it's going to actually, statistically, it's not going to make it any safer at all. How that is determined, the lights and gates, is determined by the state DOTD. We give them a portion of money every year based on how many miles of track we operate on. So do all the other railroads. The federal government kicks in some, and then the state has it in their own budget, normally, to kick in some. And then they look at the crossings all throughout the state, and they determine where they go. Costs about $250,000 to install a basic crossing, active crossing. And then once they install it, it's the responsibility of the railroad to keep it up and maintain it. So that's how that works. It's the state DOTD that actually determines where the lights and gates go in, unless your community wants to buy it themselves and put it in. And there are a couple of communities that have done that. Driving around the gates is not a really big problem I have with buses, just because it's really difficult to navigate around the gates in a bus. They're just too long, and they just don't have the turning radius. But we do have this problem. More of the problem I have with buses is stopping on top of the tracks, and it's usually because there's not enough room between the tracks and an intersection to either clear it up, or a car stops there and they're left on top of the tracks. There are some that don't work right? Because of the sensors. If you're not on the other side of the tracks, it doesn't activate the light, so you have a red light forever. That's a great time for your bus driver to call the 1-800 number. That's a problem, right? If they're having to put their bus in jeopardy to make the traffic lights work, and they're on top of the railroad crossing, call the 1-800 number. We want to know about that so that we can get out there and get it fixed. So, multiple tracks are a problem because you're going to be focused on the train you can see most of the time, and you won't be able to hear the second train because you actually will hear it, but you'll attribute those warnings to the first train that you see. We have some problems with this. There's a road in Harahan, Louisiana called Central Avenue. Don't go down. There's 7 railroad crossings owned by 3 different railroads, all right there at the base of the Huey P. Long Bridge. Got a lot of kinds of problems there. Tell your bus drivers to stay off that. There's no schools on that road, so stay off Central Avenue. But we have a lot of these throughout the state where there's multiple crossings. You'll always see the upside down T right there with it tells you how many more tracks there are. 2 tracks, 3 tracks, 4 tracks. Unfortunately, now they're 7. There may not always be a train horn. So Old Metairie Road does not have a train horn. West Monroe, and there's 2 more applied for in the state. What happens in that is the community has decided that they're going to assume the liability up to $50 million if something happens, and they pay for upgrades at the crossings, and the train horn will not blow unless there's an immediate danger that the crew realizes. So there are places where you will not hear a train horn. So those are all active crossings, and they usually have some kind of barrier to prevent you from driving around the gate. But there are a few throughout the state, and there's more that have been applied for. You have to apply to the federal government to get permission to do it, and then they carry the liability to a certain extent. So there are a few of these exempt signs. Your school bus, this is something we go over on my school bus presentation, is a little bit different. I actually go over the state law right there with them. I put it up here on the screen now. I've gone to the state law, and I show them exactly what they're required to do. My state law requires them to stop at every railroad crossing unless there's an exempt sign. If there's an exempt sign, they don't. What would happen is the train crew would pull up to that crossing, and they would stop and make sure it was okay to pull the train across before they went across the crossing. Most of your school board policies, though, say stop at every crossing. So I point that out to them, too. So, hazardous material vehicles are required to stop. I was amazed. I was telling them, blacking in vehicles. And after I gave a presentation, one of the drivers came up to me and they said, what do you mean by blacking in vehicles? And I thought, man, I'm really missing it here. These are placards. So any blacking in vehicle has to stop at every railroad crossing. I mainly emphasize that with my driver's ed kids that I teach all summer long, because if that vehicle stops in front of them and they're not anticipating that stop and they run into the back of them, they can be injured or killed. That we see a lot of that. Usually these guys are pretty good about stopping. They have to stop within 15 and 50 feet, which means 3 buses in a row can't stop at the same time and then all go across. I point that out to your bus drivers too. I had bus drivers say, well, look, I stopped in the 15-foot mark, but I still can't see. I said, well, when you stop and open your door, do you see or hear a train? And they're like, no. I said, then what do you do? They said, well, I ease up. I said, well, you've met the law. The law said you had to stop 15 to 50 feet. So you did that. Because of shrubs or whatever, they said they can't see. And then I asked them, what? Did you call it into the 1-800 number and tell if there's trees I can't see if a train's coming? If they say I'm a bus driver and I can't see because of shrubs, I hate to say it, the shrubs probably won't be there very long. All right? Because we want our bus drivers to be able to see trains. Hump crossing. This is what happened yesterday, right? It was a hump crossing and the bus got stuck. Be aware of that. Lucky thing for school buses is y'all ride pretty high. So not a big issue, but there are a couple places where I'm sure this could happen. That's knowing your route, right? Making sure the routes are good, running your routes. Speed misperception. People misjudge the train speeds all the time because it's a large object against a larger background. And so we want to make sure that they're paying attention to that. When you see a passenger airliner going across the sky, it looks like he's going fast, really slow, right? But he's actually traveling quite fast, 350, 450 miles an hour. Three don'ts. Don't pass, don't shift gears, don't stop. Most of your buses now are automatic, so that little one doesn't apply. But not stopping on the tracks is a huge issue for all vehicles that we still see. For my school buses, it's mainly stopping completely before they go across the crossing. But most of them are pretty good about slowing down, but that stop and California roll kind of blends in there. Trains hang over the tracks about 3 feet on each side. We also have things called dimensional loads that hang over even further. So that's why it's at 15 feet from the nearest rail. We want you to be back always safe enough for a train to go through there and for you to be safe. Overdriving your headlights, foggy morning, stuff like that. People running to the side of the train. The good news about this is about 80% of the people that run into the side of the train are intoxicated or using drugs. So if you don't do that, you've got an 80% chance less of running the side of the train. The other 20%, I don't know what they were thinking, right? But they sure do run into the side of the train. So most of the time, our train crew is oblivious to the fact that they've been hit. If they don't hit the engine, they're oblivious to it. And it takes us a while to track down the train, make sure it's not leaking, and make sure it's not damaged. Your bus driver should be more familiar with this than anyone else because they can see down into vehicles. People do everything in their vehicle but drive nowadays, right? Right? Yeah. I mean, I almost think vehicles are invented so people would have a place to use their phone. Right? Right? Seems like as they turn on, and now you don't even have to turn the key, right? Because the car automatically starts, you hit a button. They're hitting the buttons on their phone, right? It's almost like they have to use their phone to activate their car. And they're on there. And every day it seems like somebody invents something new to do. We do have the streetcars in New Orleans, right? They actually had an incident a while back there. We need to be careful with that. Trespassing is a huge issue. And that's enough. If police officers knew what bus drivers saw when they dropped off kids every day, crime would dramatically go down. Because for some reason, criminals are not scared to function in front of your bus drivers. So having a relationship with them really helps the law enforcement community out. If they're dropping off kids and they see them going and getting on the railroad tracks, I want to call, or I want a 1-800 number call. Call that railroad and let them know so that we go into those communities, maybe into the churches or the schools, and tell those kids just how dangerous it is to play on the tracks and be with that. Our bus drivers can help us in a big way doing that. We actually hit more pedestrians than we do people in vehicles every year. About 600 pedestrians die from being hit by the train, where only about 400 die from being hit by the train in a car. Not putting things on the tracks. I will answer the question. My knowledge, and I've asked this question a million times to people that have been on the road forever, a coin has never derailed a train, ever. I can't find anyone would even consider that even a possibility. However, that's a lot of pressure on that coin. They do shoot out at a pretty good rate sometimes if it catches a piece of it. I know in one of the parishes near Baton Rouge, some young kids were put on a railroad spike on there to smash it, and it actually shot out and went right into one of the chests of the kid. I thought he had some pretty good friends because they dragged him up to the road. A nurse driving home from work, the first car there, saw, you know, they were able to save his life. But he had a welder's pipe go all the way through, puncture his lung. So, once again, trains are big, heavy pieces of machinery. I encourage everyone to stay as far away as possible. That's what I do, because they're big, heavy pieces of machinery. Tunnels, we don't have any tunnels in Louisiana. There are in other places. When a train goes through a modern-day tunnel, there's no wiggle room in there. That's basically what dictates how big we build our trains nowadays, is how big the tunnels and bridges are. You can't jack them up and make them taller. We have a huge problem with bridges in Louisiana because we have so many of them. There's no walkway on the bridges. When our crews go out there to work on them, they wear fall protection, big harnesses to stop them from falling. But you can't do the old stand-by-me thing where you listen on the rail to see if the train is coming. We weld the rail together now, so that doesn't really, you don't hear that clicking noise, or that doesn't really, the vibrations aren't there anymore. They can move without warning. A train can actually move without the engines moving. There's slack, called slack, in between each cars. That's a cushion there made because we actually ram the cars together to open them together. And so there's cushion there. And if you have a 200 car train, you can actually have a little bit of movement or settling in those cars throughout the train, even though the engines are planted and not moving at all. So it can roll back a foot or two or three feet without the train actually technically moving. So we always encourage everyone to stay away from them, not crawl under them, through them, around them. Walking on the tracks is trespassing. It's against the law, and the reason why is because people get hurt. A lot of the advanced warning signs, parallel tracks, 18 football fields to stop a train. Look, listen, and live. For my bus drivers, it's the old one, right? Stop, look, and listen. And thank you. This is my information, my cell phone, the 25 number for the CN, my email address. That is the state director, Claude Mayer, Olomi. If you need a presentation outside of Southeast Louisiana, you can always contact Operation Lifesaver at LA.gov, and they will, he'll send mainly my North Louisiana people. We have presenters up there. There's a couple of state troopers that do it, and we have other presenters up there. They go up there. Plus, my information will be on the LASTO webpage or Facebook page, and Mr. Reese has my information too. Anything I can do to help you, I don't care that I'm actually born in Shreveport. If you have a problem in Shreveport, call me. My dad lives in Utah, and they had a train collision out there. And the investigating officer for the train crash called me down here and asked me what I thought happened, showed me some video. I gave him a couple of things to look at. And just because I work with it every day, it really helped him. So I'm all about helping anybody, anywhere. If it keeps people safe, that's what I want to do. When I lay down at night, my wife and four kids, I want to know that I've done as much as I could do to keep people safe. And by the way, all four of my children ride public school buses just like I did. So I appreciate what you do, and I appreciate what the people that work for you do. Thank you.